singing this evening. If you will take a moment now and welcome someone as we continue in the service tonight. Sing together. Go tell it.
Go tell it on the mountain, over the hills and everywhere. Go tell it on the mountain that Jesus Christ is born. And while shepherds kept their watching, poor silent flocks by night, behold, throughout the heavens, there shone a holy light. Go tell it on the mountain, over the hills and everywhere. Go tell it on the mountain that Jesus Christ is born. And down in a lowly manger, the humble Christ was born. God sent us salvation that blessed Christmas morn. Go tell it on the mountain, over the hills and everywhere. Go tell it on the mountain that Jesus Christ is born.
Amen. That is a great message to share. Amen. Jesus Christ is born over the hills and everywhere. Tell that good news. We are glad you're back, and I'm glad that you dried out a little bit this afternoon. It kind of let up right after church and has not been so bad, but man, what a day. What a day. But this is the day the Lord has made, and we'll rejoice and be glad in it. Someone was teasing me today, said, are you sure it's always sunny in 75 at Bible Baptist Church? I said, in here it is. In here it is. Amen. Forget about out there, but in here, it's sunny in 75. We're glad you're here and had a wonderful, wonderful concert. I was just disappointed that the weather affected our attendance. We were down about 30%, maybe a little more. I really wanted our congregation to hear those young people and to experience that. And of course, we had many, many watching online, but the Lord knows what he's doing. He's in control. But if you were here today or you saw it online, you know what we're talking about. It was a blessed service. Wonderful talent and ministry of singing and choral group there from University of Mobile. It was a real blessing. They're in Jacksonville tonight for a concert, and they'll be working their way back toward Alabama this week, and so you pray for them in their travels. But we're glad you're here tonight, and it's good to be back in the Lord's house. We've got our Awana ministry going on over there with their kind of the end of the first half of the year. They're wrapping up for Christmas break, and they'll be back in January for the second half of Awana. So we appreciate the workers that dedicate their time over there, and want to encourage you to keep your kids and get more kids involved in the Awana ministries. And we'll use the second half as a kickoff to get maybe pick up some new children in that ministry as well. So thank you for being with us tonight. We want to get started with prayer. And last Sunday night was our Christmas special with the choir, and the Sunday night before that, we had a guest speaker, Adolfo Rezca, missionary to Spain, and so I'm looking forward to getting back in the groove of Sunday night. Of course, next Sunday, we have a very special service. It's Christmas Eve, so there'll be carols and candlelight service next Sunday night, Christmas Eve. And then the last Sunday, we have a special fellowship evening over in the social hall. So we've got a little different calendar for the month of December, but we're glad you're here and looking forward to the time with you tonight. Let's begin with prayer before the choir sings. Father, thank you for the blessings of the day. And Lord, we know that you send the rain and those storms, so the wind is in your control, and the power of creation, Lord, that you have seen fit, Lord, to send across the country. We pray for those even north of us that are experiencing flooding and other issues as that storm moves to the north, but you have your way in the whirlwind, and Lord, all nature is under your hand and control. So we pray for your blessing and for safety. Lord, we have a lot of folks traveling this week with the Christmas week and schools being out, so we ask, Lord, for safe travels for all of them. And Lord, many on our prayer list, we'll update that with the pastor's page and some folks who are
mourning the loss of loved ones, some who are dealing with upcoming surgeries or medical procedures, some who are awaiting test results. There's a lot of anxiousness in some hearts tonight. So we just pray, Lord, for your peace that we talked about today, the peace that passes all understanding, and in every situation, in every family, Lord, that you would just grant that calm spirit and that peace. And so we thank you that you are the Prince of Peace, and we can look to you for the answers to prayer. Bless the music, the message, the fellowship, the Awana children and workers, everything that's happening here tonight at Bible Baptist Church. For your honor and glory, we pray in Jesus' name, amen. Thank you, and please be seated.
Sarah, help me out. Let's do that again. There we go. You see how dependent I am on the words, right? Let's try that again. Born as a Savior, lived among men, innocent blood, the price for all sin, humble and righteous, faithful and true, even the grave held no power cry very much. Let's stand as we continue singing together tonight. Please be seated.
Singing carols, bells are ringing, streets are bright. It's Christmas all around me, so why is Christmas hard to find? December snow is falling down like I am to my knees. I could use some hope right now, 'cause right now hope is hard to see. Help me still believe. So love this broken world, he sent his only son to a carpenter and a teenage girl to show us all his love. He left his home in heaven to make heaven my home. My Emmanuel is with me, and I'll never be alone. Down here my heart can't find much to believe. I still believe in Christmas. still believe in healing for the weary and the hurt. And in a world that's so divided, I still believe in peace on earth. I still believe the love is strong enough to conquer hate. And in a world that won't believe it, I still believe enough to say, for God so loved this broken world, He sent His only Son to a carpenter and a teenage girl to show us all His love. He left His home in heaven to make heaven my home. My Emmanuel is with me, and I'll never be alone. Down here my heart can't find much to believe in, but I still believe in Christmas. I still believe in Christmas. I still believe in Jesus, the name above all names, a Savior in a manger, a star that leads the way. Help us all believe, for God so loved this broken world, He sent His only Son to a carpenter and a teenage girl to show us all His love. He left His home in heaven to make heaven my home. My I still believe in Christmas. I still believe.
She did a great job with that, didn't she? First time I'd ever heard that. That was very good. I've got three missionary letters to read tonight. The first one is from the Evans families, who are our missionaries to Sierra Leone. It says, "Greeting friends and ministry partners. We pray this letter finds you all well as we all look forward to this upcoming Christmas season. The end of this month has been met with some unexpected challenges here in Ceylon. In recent days, on November 26th, the capital city of Freetown faced attack from within in an attempted coup, creating a time of chaos and uncertainty. In response, security forces are navigating the turbulent situation following the attacks, which claimed lives, illegally released more than 1,800 prisoners, and led to a nationwide curfew. As of the writing of this update, the weekend here in Freetown continued in calm, for which we are incredibly grateful, and the curfew is still in place, as security forces are still in pursuit of the assailants and illegally released prisoners. Please join us and continue to pray for the safety of all involved, wisdom of the authorities, and a swift restoration of peace. At this time, we remain in country. With this in mind, it is crucial to lift our upcoming ministry endeavors in heartfelt prayer. Sean is scheduled to teach at a multi-day pastor's conference in the area of Kono, several hours upline from the capital city. Investing in local pastors as they seek to lead their churches and communities in biblical truth is imperative, and this opportunity is significant in equipping those pastors in their Great Commission endeavors. Simultaneously, we are in the beginning stages of the verification process of legal documents and deeds for a potential property purchase. This is a long process and the first step of many before we even begin the negotiation attempts for this potential parcel of land. Thank you for your continued prayers and support of our family and the ministry here in Sierra Leone, and we wish you a very Merry Christmas. Prayer requests include the unrest in Sierra Leone and peace in the country, the upcoming pastor's conference, wisdom in the potential property we are seeking to acquire, should the Lord allow, and the legal process involved." And those are our missionaries to Sierra Leone. The Hoaglands, who are missionaries to Mexico, if I remember correctly, says, "Dear prayer partners, Anita and I wish you a very Merry Christmas 2023 and a Happy New Year 2024. Not every day we get to see our two volcanoes on the east side of the city, but today, on December 1, 2023, we had clear and beautiful view of them this morning. God is such a great artist. Our trips to Acapulco were a blessing for many affected by Hurricane Otis. The first one was a one-day trip with 15 people where we gave out food baskets, water, clothes, diapers, medicine, and other supplies. We also gathered 124 people and presented the gospel to them with 23 professions of faith in Jesus Christ. 2 weeks later, we sent another team, four construction workers and an evangelist who spent 6 days repairing a church that was damaged, giving out more water and food baskets, and giving the gospel and words of hope to many. They saw another 17 believe in Jesus Christ as their personal Savior. At our main church in Mexico City, Iglesia Bautista de la Capital, we had a very fruitful month of November. God gave us 78 salvation decisions with 6 baptisms. We give God all the glory and the praise for the increase He has blessed us with. In December, we ask you to pray for 2 evangelistic events. First is Friday the 15th, which is our Christmas program and the last day of classes for 2023 at our small Christian school of 40 students. Many of the parents, family, and friends of our students will be there and will give the gospel to them. And we're still in need of a second grade teacher starting in January. If you know of anyone, please contact me. And then the next day, Saturday the 16th, will be our Christmas program at our main church. It will be outdoors in the parking lot with our choir and another message from God's Word. We plan to have 50 new and needy families with us to give them a few food basket, and our people will be inviting others to celebrate the birth of the Messiah in this world. We will end that day with dinner on the grounds. Please pray that God will again bless our efforts and work with many more souls coming to Christ and wanting to become a follower of Him. Let's all be thankful for all that God has done for us, is doing, and will one day do. Have you counted your blessings? God bless, Ed and Anita Hoagland, missionaries to Mexico. And then the final letter is Jason and Sarah Jordan. They're missionaries to Cuba. It says, "Dear pastor and church family, it has been a tremendous joy to serve the Lord in Cuba. Many people have been saved, baptized, and called to the ministry because of what the Lord has done. We would like to thank every one of you who have given to our ministry. We couldn't be in Cuba without the generous giving which the Lord has provided through you. We have made our final trip into Cuba for the 2023 calendar year. It was a blessing as I had the opportunity to work alongside our JEM team. During the trip, we spent our time in the city of Cienfuegos, working in adult ministry and children's ministry. Mrs. Victoria, which is Henry's wife, oversaw a major women's outreach in the form of a baby shower, and 108 women accepted Christ as Savior. We had our biggest children's outreach ever with over 800 in attendance, and 200 accepted Christ as Savior. In total, through those ministries, nightly church services, and street evangelism, there were 678 people saved. All glory to Him. Our family would like to thank every church who has scheduled us to come and present our ministry as JEM missionaries and have already taken us on for support. Please pray for us as we will be focusing more on deputation this year, raising the money needed to be full-time, and that is Jason and Sarah Jordan, missionaries to Cuba." So let's pray, and then Pastor will come preach. Lord, we love you. Lord, just reading these letters of all these people who are now children of God. What a blessing, Father. I thank you so much that you were born, but you were born to die. You were born to die for our sins. And Lord, you did it because you love us. And Lord, I just pray that you'll continue to bless our missionaries and bless us as we support our missionaries around the world and here in Savannah. Lord, continue to pour out your blessing. Lord, protect these missionaries, especially those that are in harm's way, and keep them safe. Put a hedge of protection about them. Lord, we love you. We look forward to seeing you one day face to face. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you, Brother Paul. Those are tremendous reports from Mexico and Cuba. And we're seeing the Lord do some amazing things around the world. He's not done saving people, amen? He's not done. Revival is still happening in lots of places. Those letters, as I was reading them earlier, reminded me of how it was there in the 90s and early 2000s in places like the Philippines and other places. You're hearing of hundreds being saved at a time, and it's great to know that that is still happening around the world, and that we get to be a part of that by supporting these missionaries. And Cuba, of course, just now opened up here in the last few years, so you've got people there that have not heard the gospel in 60 or 70 years, 50 at least, and now they're getting exposed to the preaching of God's word. So keep praying for our missionaries, and I know it's been a couple weeks since we shared letters, so you remember them. We were just working on the budget in our deacons meeting, and we are anticipating increasing our missions giving next year, giving all of our missionaries a monthly raise. We haven't done that in about 5 years, so we're going to be increasing our missionary support, Lord willing, in the new year for all of those families, and keeping them in our prayers and in the forefront. And we've not given up on a missions trip where we're working on a couple different things. We have invitations all over the world, actually, missionaries asking us to send help and visits, and so we'll try to get some of those things on the calendar as well. Well, in your Bibles tonight, John chapter 10, we invite you to stand as we read God's word together. And Amanda, I want to echo Brother Paul and thank you for that beautiful song and the choir song tonight. I had not heard Amanda sing before, and I had not heard that song before, but now all of you have a better understanding on why we hired Austin Dixon. Amen? Amen. John chapter 10 and verse number 9, Jesus said these words, "I am the door. By me, if any man enter in, he shall be saved, and shall go in and out and find pasture. The thief cometh not but for to steal and to kill and to destroy. I am come that they might have life, and that they might have it more abundantly." And all God's people said, amen. Man, thank you, and please be seated. You hear me say often that I'm glad that saved is not just a Baptist word, it's a Bible word, right? But even more than a Bible word, it's a Jesus word. He said it there in verse number 9, that by me, if any man enter in, he shall be saved. By me, if any man. We talked about this morning, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. And so Jesus himself uses the word saved. Don't be ashamed or embarrassed to talk about being saved, or to ask someone if they're saved. Jesus did it here. And then our focus tonight, and I know we're close to Christmas now, just a week away from tomorrow, and all families have traditions, and I referenced the Charlie Brown Christmas movie this morning, and one of our favorite family Christmas movies, it didn't used to be until actually I became an adult, was the first time I actually really saw this, was It's a Wonderful Life. How many of you remember Jimmy Stewart? You know him? Yes. Well, he was a great American, and he was a World War II pilot. I saw his bomber jacket at the Air Force Museum in Dayton, Ohio. He served his country in the United States Air Force during World War II. Matter of fact, It's a Wonderful Life was the first movie he made when the war ended, and he was reluctant. They were reluctant to ask him because of PTSD and other things. If he wanted to just, if he could flip that switch and go right from the wartime things that he had to do into back into Hollywood, and but he did. And that movie is the theme or the inspiration for this title, and I've shared it over the years. It's a Wonderful Life, Secrets to a Wonderful Life. And whether you watch the movie or don't know anything about the movie, well, that's beyond the point. But all that movie, if you're familiar with it, has a lot of great memorable lines. I remember the one time he asked his Uncle Billy the three greatest words to man, and Billy said, "Breakfast is served, lunch is served, dinner is served." Okay. Oh, come on, that's funny right there. I don't care who you are, okay? But in that Wonderful Life, there are some secrets to that movie. I looked up some trivia about it, and maybe you knew this, maybe you didn't know this. But the movie is based on a short story called The Greatest Gift. It was written by a man named Philip Van Doren Stern in 1939. And it didn't start out as a book. He couldn't get a publisher, so he sent it. He put it in the form of a Christmas story, a 20-page little booklet, and he sent it to 200 people that he knew as just a Christmas gift, a story that he had written. And somebody got a hold of that copy, and then they sent it to a magazine called Good Housekeeping. Anybody remember that magazine, Good Housekeeping, and Better Homes and Gardens, all of that? And Good Housekeeping published the story in 1945 under the title, The Man Who Was Never Born. That's a little bit of trivia behind that, how that story came into being. Cary Grant, here's another secret, was originally asked to play George Bailey, but was replaced by Jimmy Stewart, as I said. They were afraid to ask Jimmy Stewart if he would want to do that, and he agreed. And so Cary Grant moved to a different movie called The Bishop's Wife, if anybody's ever seen that Christmas movie. Anyway, Stewart was reluctant to star in the film, having just returned from World War II, but he agreed to do it. Here's something you may not know about the movie. The movie was shot in the summer of 1945, during an intense heat wave in California. Some of the filming days reached 100 degrees. And sometimes when you see Jimmy Stewart sweating, it's not because of stress or because of the scene per se. It's because it was hot where they were filming. Here's something that happened. It's a Wonderful Life brought this into Hollywood. Prior to that movie, fake snow in the movies was made out of painted cornflakes. True story. I knew they were good for something. They painted them white and used them for snow in movies. But this special effect was too noisy. And Frank Capra ordered a new type of snow to be invented. Somehow he said, find me something. And so they experimented with a lot of things, and they found a firefighting chemical named fomite, F-O-A-M-I-T-E, and they mixed that with sugar and water to make the snow that was used in the movie, to get away from that crunching sound of the cornflakes. They used 6,000 tons of that snow, 6,000 pounds of that snow in the movie. Here's something you ladies will know, will like this. Donna Reed, who plays Mary, they had a stuntman ready to break the window for her when she throws the rock at the old Granville house, but she had played softball in college, and she insisted on throwing the rock herself, and on the first try, she broke the window. They didn't even need the stuntman, and Donna Reed really did break the window in the Granville house. Here's something, a secret. The movie was nominated for 5 major Oscar awards, but did not win any. It didn't win an award for technical something, some kind of not a big deal thing, but they did win one award, but no Oscars. And it really did not become a beloved Christmas movie until the rights expired in the 1970s, and that allowed any station in America that wanted to play that movie for free, and they began to play it just to have a holiday specials and fill-ins, and it kind of took off. It developed an audience and a following in the 1970s, and today is ranked as one of the favorite Christmas movies of American culture. Here's something you may or may not know, and if you haven't seen the movie, I hope now you'll go watch it. Skylar, have you ever seen the movie? It's a Wonderful Life. You need to watch it. It's a tradition for Lonnie. You can start that. Here's something you may not know. The gym floor, remember that opened during the high school dance? The gym floor opened over the pool? That really did happen. That really existed. And that pool and that floor are still in use at Beverly Hills High School in Beverly Hills, California. That was a real pool and a real floor, and it's still in use today. Here's something, if your eyes are sharp, you find a character who was known as Alfalfa. From The Little Rascals, he has a minor role in that film. He's the one that is spurned by George Bailey and Mary, and he's the one who gets the key and opens the pool. And Alfalfa from The Little Rascals was in that movie. Here's something. The film did not do well at the box office. It actually lost money, and they thought it was a flop. Until years later when, again, it became resurgent. And the last little secret from It's a Wonderful Life that I'll share with you, in the movie at the end, kind of the climax of the action, Uncle Billy loses $8,000. Remember that? He misplaces it in the newspaper, and Mr. Potter gets it and hides it, keeps it. Today, in 2023, that $8,000 would be over $136,000. So you see why there was such a stress about all that at that time. That was a lot of money to lose in one day, and especially when you had a bank examiner waiting to see the books and you couldn't come up with $136,000. You'd be toast, amen? Well, that's just a little bit of fun trivia about It's a Wonderful Life, and you can go and watch it. But the title for the movie is the thought behind tonight's message. We know that life on this earth is temporary. I referenced this morning two men that I heard of dying unexpectedly. One was 48, one was 58 years old. This morning I talked about that. Parents having to bury their children. The Bible says that our life is just a vapor. It appears for a little while and then vanishes away. Life is also fragile. Very fragile. With the biblical average of human life given to be 70 years, or by reason of strength, 80 years, but life is very fragile. I don't mean to be morbid about this, but I take note of strange ways that people die. And maybe it's because of my chaplain work and having to deal with a lot of death over the years, but strange ways that people die. Just this week in a part of our country, there was a husband and a wife coming the same, going opposite directions, and crashed head-on into one another. Killed them both. One was coming home, one was going to town. And then head-on collision, killed them both. A 20-some-year-old duck hunter, Pastor Hubbard, be careful, down in Oklahoma or Missouri, walking out to retrieve a duck, hit a drop-off in the water, went down, water filled his waders, and immediately pulled him under 20 feet of water. He drowned, 20-some years old. And so life is very fragile. My family was coming home last night. There was a fatal accident on 17 south of Quaco Road. You don't know. And so the Bible talks about life being a vapor and being fragile, and we must take care. And if the average age is 70 years, according to the scripture, or by reason of strength, 80 years, and we got some strong people at Bible Baptist, because many of you have blown right past 80 and you're still cooking. Amen? You're still moving on. And so I think it's because you stay home in the rain. That's what I think is what happens. And it keeps you healthier. You know, reading about 70 and 80 years, when I was 20, that seemed like a long time. But now that I'm 40, 50, keep going. I haven't hit 60 yet. No. But now 80 doesn't seem so long. 80 doesn't seem so long. And I think about, you know, my grandparents passed away and older relatives, and I think, oh, they had a long life. And then as I'm getting close to where they were, I'm thinking, that's not long enough. Life itself is short. But in this life, whatever years God has given us, we are allowed to make choices with this life that we've been given. Life is a gift, isn't it? And so we've been allowed to make choices with our life. And someone has said that life is truly made up of 10% of what happens to you and 90% of how you respond to what happens. You ever heard that before? The events of your life make up about 10%, but how you react and respond to those events is what the rest of your life is made up of and how you deal with that. And so there are some not so hidden secrets to a wonderful life. And I've shared some of these in past years, I'm sure, but put it together kind of in a little message to go with that theme. We can have a wonderful life. Jesus said here that he's come that we might have life and have it more abundantly. And when we think of abundance, I know we don't, you probably could go through weeks of your life and never use the word abundant. Right? I mean, it's just not part of our normal conversation. Say, oh, that's an abundant amount of food we have in the refrigerator. Or, my wife's closet has an abundant amount of clothes. We were visiting someone, old Paul, and he was showing us his house that just remodeled. And he said, and that's my wife's closet. And that's my closet. Any husbands want to brave enough to say amen? Yeah. Some wives have whole rooms for their closets. You know, the kids move out and they take over that room. We don't use abundant. We really don't talk about it much. At Thanksgiving time, we might say there was an abundance of food. But we don't use the word. Jesus used the word. He said, I've come that they have life and they have it more abundantly. And of course, when we do use the word, being materialistic people, we think of things, an abundance of things, an abundance of money, an abundance of food, right? When we hear abundance, we just think, and it does mean a bountiful, it does mean more than enough, but it's not relegated to simply material things or possessions. Jesus said a man's life consists not in the things that he possesses. Amen? So when he's talking about abundantly, he's not talking about possessions, because he kind of upbraids them for that thinking in another place of Scripture. He's thinking about abundant life that is internal, abundant life that is represented by contentment and joy and peace, as I talked about this morning, and love and those types of things. He's come that we might have all of that and so much more. And so how can we have a wonderful life? We can have a wonderful life through the abundant life that Christ offers. And here, let me give you a couple things, and they're just, I guess, kind of cliches, but let's work together on it real quick. We can have a wonderful life by enjoying life and not just enduring life. Sadly, too many people are going through life just enduring. They're just getting by. And you'll hear them say, well, how are you doing? Well, I'm okay under the circumstances, right? I'm okay under the circumstances, or I guess I'm doing fine, or I'll get by. But the Lord doesn't want us to just get by. He wants us to enjoy life. Notice in verse 10, he said, the thief cometh not but for to steal and to kill and to destroy. I am come that they might have life and that they might have it more abundantly. He's not talking about the years in your life, but the life in your years, as someone has well said. The life in your years, not just the quantity, but the quality. Not just the time here on earth, but what consists of that time. What does that time consist of? And again, the word abundantly means over and above, more than necessary, something more or uncommon. Think about that for a minute. Jesus said that the life of his children should be uncommon. Uncommon. Not normal. When you look around this crowd, there's a lot of not normal. I see it. Your life shouldn't be just the mundane. Amen? For the child of God, every day is a gift. For the child of God, every day is an opportunity. For the child of God, every day is a chance to rejoice in his blessings and his care. And so we don't just go through the motions of life. Get up, go to work, earn a living. Get up, go to work, earn a living. Pay the bills, do this, do that. Pay my taxes and die. And then pay more taxes after you die. The world just goes through this motion, right? They just have this school and then college and then marriage and then work for 40 years and then retire and go to Florida. And just wait around. Wait around. We had some friends, a lot of snowbirds in Ohio that come south in the winter. And remember, he's in heaven now. But they had they're out there in this yard, and they're just laying in the sun. And they're just, which is another funny thing to me, because we would come down. The first time I ever went to Florida, I thought, this is the silliest thing. You got these old people from the north. They come down and sit on the beach and wrap themselves in blankets. What's the point? You know what I'm saying? So anyway, or we went to SeaWorld, and the workers, true story, had shorts on and gloves. They're cold in January in Florida. And so they're laying there on these lounge chairs, and she nudges them. She said, hey, you better move a little bit. The buzzards are circling. So we hurry through life, we raise our kids, we do our job, we go retire, and then we just sit around and wait to die. That's the common plan of man, right? But our life is to be uncommon. Our life is to be abundant. And certainly I'm not against retirement or Florida or any of those activities. What I'm saying is Jesus wants us to have something more than the world has. If in this life only we have hope, we are of all men most miserable. That doesn't sound like we're living abundant life. If we're being miserable, that's not abundant life. And listen, if you're miserable, you're probably making the people around you pretty miserable. So not only are you infringing, you're missing out on your abundant life, but you're sucking the life out of other people because you're not living up to God's expectation and what he has provided for you. And in that we could have more in this life than is necessary, not in wealth or possessions, but in peace and contentment. Godliness with contentment, the Bible said, is great gain. It's a life that realizes that our life is not about things or possessions. And he said that your joy might be full. Notice John 15, verse 9. John 15, as the Father hath loved me, so have I loved you. Continue ye in my love. Verse 10, if you keep my commandments, ye shall abide in my love, even as I've kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. In verse 11, these things have I spoken unto you, that my joy might remain in you, and that your joy might be what? Full. Full. He wants us to be full of joy. And we sing joy to the world. The Lord has come. And so he's made it possible through his salvation. He's made it possible through his presence. He's made it possible through his blessings and promises for our joy to be full. I've brought you this joy that you might have a fullness here. Joy starts with salvation, amen? And if you're saved but not enjoying life, then according to the shepherd, something's wrong with you. If you're saved, if you're a child of God and not enjoying life, then you're just enduring life. And according to the shepherd, something's wrong. The sheep need a checkup because he came that we might have life and have it more abundantly. He brought joy that our joy could be full. It is joy unspeakable and full of glory. It may be if we're not enjoying life as a child of God. Now, unsaved people don't have this option, amen? They just deal, they have to deal with whatever they have to deal with. They have no real joy, internal joy. They may have happiness. They may have temporary happiness. They may win the lottery and be happy for a while. But stay with me. Saved people don't have any reason not to have joy because of our salvation. And so if we're not enjoying life, if we're not experiencing this wonderful life of joy, it may be sin. Maybe sin in our life, right? That will rob you of joy. It may be hard-heartedness. You've become jaded by the culture that we live in. You've lost the joy of your salvation. David talked about that, didn't he? After his sin and his brokenness, he said, "Restore unto me the joy of thy salvation," so you can lose that joy. We know what happened to David, the man after God's own heart who was writing those psalms. Think about that. This morning in Sunday school, life groups, happy hour with Hubbard, whatever you call it. We're reading Psalm 103. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. That same guy says, restore unto me the joy of thy salvation. We can lose our joy. David lost his joy. He didn't lose his salvation. He lost his joy because of sin and because of hard-heartedness. It could be pride that robs you of joy. It could be selfishness. It could be your attitude. There's a book in my office that says, "Don't look now, but your attitude is showing." It could be bitterness that's robbing you of joy. But according to the shepherd, if you're just enduring life, if you're just trying to get by and you're not enjoying, Something is hindering you. Something's not right. Listen, Christians have hardships. Christians have stress. Christians have fatigue. I have to be careful of that because when I'm under a lot of stress or fatigue, these headaches can get really bad. We have sadness at times. But if we are only enduring life, then something is out of balance. If we're not enjoying our walk with God, if we're not enjoying the blessings of God, something's out of balance. And each stage of life is different, amen? I'm in a new stage of life. But every day of life is a gift from God. And we should be aware of His blessings and His moving in our lives no matter what age we're at, amen? I had a whole different focus in my 20s, a whole different focus in my 30s, now a whole different focus in my 50s. And think with me, every stage of life is different, but there's joy in every part of the journey. For the child of God, there should be joy in every part of the journey. Remember the old song, "And He walks with me and He talks with me." And buddy, that's going to continue right on until we're like Enoch and he was not because God took him. And we're going to walk with him all the way to heaven. And there's joy for every part of the journey. Even in the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. And so think with me, are you enjoying life? If you want a wonderful life, you've got to enjoy life, not just endure it. Number two, we can have a wonderful life by growing as God's people and not grumbling as God's people. Uh-oh. 2 Peter 3:18. But grow in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. To Him be glory both now and forever. Amen. Can I let you in on a little secret? When you stop growing in Christ, you start getting grumpy. It's kind of like the spiritual follows the physical. And I'm just going to let you in on another little secret. Most young people think old people are grumpy. Pretty much. You know why they think that? Because most of you are grumpy. No, stay with me. If we're not continually growing in our walk with the Lord, and I'm just telling you, I've been at this a long time, been saved since I was 7 years old. And I have met some senior citizen Christians who are the sweetest, dearest, kindest, most loving people you could ever meet. And I have met some senior citizen Christians who are cranky, mean-spirited, grumpy. Now, what's the problem? They have the same Lord. They're both saved. I'm not saying they're not saved. You might not think they're saved, but their testimony is they're saved. What's the difference? Well, they just didn't have it as hard as I did. No, you stopped growing in the Lord, and they kept walking with the Lord. They're still excited about the Word of God. They're still excited about church. They're still excited about prayer. They're still excited about giving. They're still singing the praises of God. And it has to do with growing in faith and knowledge and continuing your walk. And when you get to the point where you think you know it all and you don't have to read your Bible anymore, you don't have to pray anymore, and you don't have to go to church anymore, you don't have to witness anymore because you know it all, just ask you, you'll tell us. When you get to that point, you become cranky, you become grumpy. You don't have to be 50 or 60 or 80 to do that. Any Christian who stops growing in the Lord gets that kind of attitude, gets that kind of persona. And stay with me. This is a command to grow. He said, grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord. And we must follow that command. We must grow in grace. We must learn grace. We must practice grace. We must extend grace to others. And grow, he says, in the knowledge of the Lord. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. So we've got to keep taking in the Word of God. It's hard to teach somebody that already knows everything. Amen? So we've got to constantly be students. You will hear me say from this pulpit, I'm not a Bible scholar, I'm a Bible student. I'm still learning. I'm still taking it in. I'm still finding treasures in the Word of God and in the way He deals and the way He directs the affairs of men. I'm still learning. And so you grow in the knowledge of the Lord. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. And we can pray more. We can read more. We can give more. We can dig deeper. We can reach farther. We can plan bigger. We can trust more. And when I find people that, it doesn't matter their age, when they're walking with the Lord and they're growing in the grace and knowledge of Christ, they're living that wonderful life. They're living that joy of the Lord, which is their strength. When we quit growing, again, we get grumpy, but when we're growing, we're fresh, we're happy, we're excited about the things of God, we're excited about the church, and people who are growing spiritually are the ones who are excited. I've shared, and I don't want to embarrass them, they're on their honeymoon, but that young couple that just got married Friday, they're going to get baptized here soon. And we're doing these meetings and the counseling stuff, they're repeating things to me that they heard me say in the message. I'm not going to put anybody on the spot here. But if I asked most of you what I preached last Sunday, you probably couldn't remember it. I don't know if I could remember it. But they remember it. And they're quoting back to me things that I said and illustrations I gave and verses that I referenced, because it's fresh and it's new and it's exciting, and they can't get enough. They're growing. Amen? And those people are exciting and they're happy. And when you think about it, people who are growing spiritually are the ones who are attending, they're involved, they are learning from God's word. They're the ones who, and the ones who are not growing are the ones who are not doing anything. They're satisfied with the status quo. Many a Baptist has claimed the song, I shall not be moved, as their testimony. They've reached the pinnacle. They're done. I shall not be moved. And preacher, I just dare you to bless me today. Just try it. Well, if you're only enduring life and not enjoying life, that's a sad place to be, but you don't need to stay there. So how do you have a wonderful life? You grow in the Lord. No matter how much you think you know, you don't know. Amen? You don't know it all. You don't know it all. I don't know it all. And so we grow in the Lord, and it keeps that joy and that excitement and that freshness, that newness of life. We're to walk in newness of life, amen? Not oldness of life, to walk in newness of life. How do we have a wonderful life? Secrets to a wonderful life. Number three, I want to challenge you, especially in the new year coming. This is not a New Year's message, but it'll be here before you know it. In the new year, spend more time looking up than you do looking around. Jesus said, when you see these things begin to come to pass, lift up your heads, for your redemption draws nigh. And to have that wonderful life, to keep that joy of the Lord as your strength, come to the point where you're spending more time looking up. Look at Hebrews chapter 12, verse 1. Wherefore, seeing we also are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which does so easily beset us, and let us run with patience the race that is set before us. Verse 2, looking unto Jesus. Now, where is Jesus right now? I know He's in our heart, and I know He's everywhere. He's God. He's omnipresent. But where does the Bible say He is right now? He's at the right hand of the throne of on high. Amen. He's seated at the Father's right hand. And so we look up to Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the what, church? Joy that was set before Him, endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. And so to have a wonderful life, secrets to that, is to look unto Jesus. Keep your eyes fixed on Him. The world distracts us and wants our focus and attention. Just be real transparent. I'm bad about this. I like to know what's going on in the world. I like to be up to date. I don't want to be caught off guard when people say something about this or that. And I like to know what's happening in politics and the war and Israel and all of that. And I stay. But the problem with that is that you can get overcome by all the distraction of the world. You can become burdened by the sin of the world, the negative things that are happening. I mean, we're just marching. Robert Bork wrote a book in the 1980s, Slouching Towards Sodom. We're not slouching towards Sodom. We are running towards Sodom. And you can get overcome by the things that are happening in the world. And there's a balance there, I know, and you got to be careful to know what's going on, but not to make that the focus. Jesus is to be the focus, amen? The Word of God is to be the focus. Heaven is to be the focus. Lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven, and to be heavenly minded, and to keep our eyes on Him. The world distracts us and wants our focus and attention. God doesn't care about the newest iPhone. God doesn't care about this movie or that movie. God doesn't care about political polls. Amen? He doesn't care about Starbucks. He doesn't care about Nike. He doesn't care about any of that stuff. So don't get so enamored with the things of the world that you lose that heavenly mindedness. For the souls of men and the cares of this world don't rob you of the riches of your joy. That's good preaching right there. If we look around instead of looking to Jesus, we can be overwhelmed with cares, with circumstances, with presumed needs. I say that, presumed needs, because most of what we presume that we need, God says you don't need that. Did you get a hold of that? Most of what you and I, they say that right? Yeah, you and I, most of what we think we need, God said, you don't need that. You need your eyes on me. You need to focus on me. Much of what we think we need is self-prescribed. It's not God-prescribed. And He is the great physician, amen? So don't give yourself a prescription. Take God's prescription and focus on what He wants for you more than what you need. Listen to this. There are things we all need. We need food, we need housing, we need clothes on our back. I went 3 weeks without a watch. I really didn't need it, but my wife finally broke down and bought me one. I was getting a lot of hate mail. Please get a watch, please get a watch. Please. No, I wasn't. I didn't really need it. I figure when you all start getting up and walking out, I've preached long enough, amen? Sit down. There's a lot of things we think we need, and there are some real needs. There are some real needs. I don't discount that. But you know what? I don't have one need. I could not write down one need that I have that compares to the need of a lost soul bound for hell. There is not one need that I have that compares to a man dying and spending eternity in hell. His need is far greater than anything I have. His need is more serious than anything I have. And so we need to just put our thoughts in order for a minute. I don't need an 85-inch television. I don't need a new car. I don't need a new house. I don't need a new suit. Some of my suits are a little big now. I've lost a little weight, but I'm not buying new suits because I may put that weight back. And what a waste of God's resources that would be. Amen? I don't need what I think I need compared to the need of a man who's dying without Christ. And so look up. Don't look around to the wants of the flesh. Lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven. Lay where? Lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven. The things of God should be our focus, not the things of this world. Abraham looked up for a city whose builder and maker is God. Lot looked around at the plains of Sodom. There's a good contrast. Abraham looked up. Lot looked around.
Abraham pleased God, the Bible says, and Lot destroyed his family. So spend more time, if you want a wonderful life, spend more time looking up than you do looking around. And then lastly, secrets to a wonderful life. You and I can have that joy and that abundant life, and our joy may be full, if we would spend more time surrendering to God instead of striving with God. Notice Isaiah 45:9 is the text. Woe unto him that striveth with his maker. Let the potsherd strive with the potsherds of the earth. Shall the clay say to him that fashioneth it, what makest thou, or thy work? He hath no hands. And so the illustration is the pottery going to say to the potter, what are you doing? What do you think you're doing? Is the creation going to say to the creator, hey, I don't think you're doing this right. I think you made a mistake. I don't think, God, I don't take this personal, but I'm not really sure you know what you're doing. Whew. Woe unto him that striveth with his maker. The saying says, your arms are too short to box with God. But yet so many people think they're going to do it. I'm going to do it. But what are you fighting with God about? Some people, maybe even here tonight, you're fighting with God about your soul. You know you need to be saved, but you're fighting with God about that. You say, no, I'm going to do it my own way. I'm going to do it when I want to. I'm going to do it in my own way. I've had people say that to me. I said, do you know that you're saved? Well, I'm saved in my own way. Well, I didn't know you had a plan of salvation named after you. I'm saved in my own way. No, there's only one way to be saved. And it's not the Baptist way or the Methodist way or the Lutheran way, amen? It's God's way. It's through the Savior, Jesus Christ. That's the only way to be saved. I am the way, Jesus said, the truth and the life. No man comes to the Father but by me. So are you striving with your maker about your soul? Are you trying to save yourself? Are you trying to establish your own righteousness and somehow God's going to make an allowance for you because you're better than everybody else, or you've got this figured out, or you deserve it? No. You surrendering? Are you striving with God about your soul? Are you striving with God about serving the Lord? God's calling you to do a certain thing and you're not willing to yield. You're not willing to surrender. I surrender all is the song. Are you striving with God about that? He's calling you. He's pleading with you. The Holy Spirit is convicting you about something, but you're just striving with God. No, God, not today, not now, not going to do it. Maybe it's some sin that you won't let go of and God has convicted you of it and you know you need to give it up. You know you need to get it under the blood of Christ, but you're just striving with God. You're saying, I'm going to go another round. Kind of like Pharaoh, amen? He suffered and he thought he was going to break, and then he said, no, I'm going to go another round. I'm going to go another round. How did that work out for him? Not so good. Can I say this to you in loving pastoral counsel? Every man who fights with God loses. No, he's undefeated. You're never going to fight with God about anything and win. God is never going to blink. There's no value or wisdom in holding out against God. So why not just surrender, do what he asks, and go ahead and live that abundant life in Christ? Go ahead and have your joy full. Go ahead and have that wonderful blessings of God now, while your life is still a vapor that appears for a little while. God wants us to have abundant life. I could go on, but our time is gone. And these are kind of a play on words, some secrets about a wonderful life. It really is not a secret, is it? These are all simple, simple truths. But sometimes we can't see the forest for the trees. And we're not paying attention. And we just need to be reminded once in a while. Don't endure life. Enjoy life. Don't grumble, but grow. Don't look around. Look up. And don't strive with God, but surrender to God. And it really will be a wonderful life. Amen? Let's bow in prayer. Father, thank you for our time around your word. I pray that you would use this simple Christmas message as illustrations here to remind us not only of this season, but Lord, of the reason you came. I came to give them life and that they might have it more abundantly. And so we thank you that Jesus came, that he lived and that he died and that he rose again. And he left his spirit, Lord, to dwell within us, that we might not just endure life, but enjoy life. And so help us to learn from these scriptures tonight and from these illustrations. If there be someone tonight, Lord, that does not know Christ as their Savior, I pray that tonight, whether online or here in this auditorium, they would call upon the name of the Lord. And they would ask you to forgive them of their sins, to save their soul, and to begin that new life in Christ, to walk in newness of life. Bless this invitation, we pray and ask in Jesus' name, amen. Would you stand and join us as we sing?